Hello. This is a brief mic check. One more. Welcome aboard. We'll get going here as soon as it gets fully dark. See, it's still a little bit blue in the background there. So in the meantime, this is globular cluster M3 in Canada's Natick and the TC, however you say it. The galaxies will have to be done at full dark because we've already got the moon out. And, this would just make it worse in twilight. Howdy, Krista. How are you? I think I'm getting close here to being ready. Dish. The deck will quit bobbing around. Just so you know what tonight is about, we were going to look at some of the various galaxies that Mr. Edwin Hubble, back when he was first using large reflector telescopes, had classified according to what he considered to be their development history and how they would develop over time, going from elliptical galaxies, which basically show little to no structure at all, over to these spiral galaxies on the right side of the chart there. So we're going to look at some of the different examples of that are in the sky. Ooh, Vegemite snacks. Yeah, sorry, those were gone a long time ago. In fact, they were gone on like the second day after you sent them. I shared them at work. People like them. So anyway, this one here is the galaxy they just had that big press release about recently. I don't know if you saw it down there, the M87 with the black hole that they actually had a visual image of the event horizon of the black hole. And this little feature right here sticking off the side that I Yeah, I think that is the general consensus, is that the Milky Way is a barred spiral. On that classification diagram, I think it would be roughly an SB spiral with a sort of slightly open configuration. We're definitely not this wide open, and we're not this tightly wound. So I'd imagine we're somewhere around here. Maybe in between these two. It's one of those things that's really hard to tell, and when we're actually inside it. So we'll let this guy stack for a while before we move on to, I've got a few laid out here. We'll go to an E3 next, which will be obviously quite a bit more squashed looking than this one. This is a 6-inch refractor with ASI 294 camera attached to it, which is really nice because I can control everything from right here inside. Hello, Dave. How are you? Now we're getting a bit of resolution and detail in the jet there. You can at least see it's a different color than the core of the galaxy slightly. A little more bluish, it looks like. Yeah, well, you can have it for a few months. I'm tired of it. Our winter finally has left us. Today was our first 25 degree day this year. All right, we're gonna move quickly here to another elliptical, and this is M86 coming up, and I have to move quickly because they're getting pretty high in the south, and the scope is gonna be crossing the meridian soon if I don't hurry. It's right next door to M87, actually. And so if M87 there is an example of an E0 galaxy, which has got a more or less round shape. You can see right here, it's classified between an E0 and an E1. M86 is over here at an E3, so it should be noticeably more squished looking. and some of the other ones around it. We've got M84 over here on the lower right, and that's also an elliptical. There are a lot of elliptical galaxies in the Virgo cluster, and then above it we've got NGC 4402, which is an almost edge-on spiral galaxy, very similar to the Milky Way, actually, classification-wise. I don't know why it keeps... Sorry about that. This is what happens with live. Hello, you two. Thank you for joining Bonesy and Aiden Woods. Anyway, M86, M84, NGC something, NGC something else. If we can get 5 good frames, yay. We'll move on. Do have it balanced. Right, I'm not going to linger too long on this one because there's one more here in Virgo that we need to get to real fast before it heads south over the meridian, and that is M59. An M59, assuming this doesn't take 10 minutes to settle down, which on our diagram here is quite elliptical, so it should be fairly obviously egg-shaped. M60 over here is actually this little guy, and it's classified as a barred spiral, nearly face on. And you can sort of see the barred shape here in the center with these rings coming off of it. The big one next to it is actually NGC 4647, which is yet another elliptical. And then over here on the side, we've got GC 4607, which is nearly edge-on spiral, sort of like the Milky Way. And other scattered minor galaxies in the field. Chris, right now Andromeda has set. It's currently below the horizon. You wouldn't see it right now until early, early morning. But normally we do, yes. It is a northern hemisphere galaxy. We don't see the Magellanic Clouds, though. That's one thing I'm really jealous of. Tell which one that is. That would be NGC 4638. Which is a lenticular galaxy. And lenticulars are interesting. They usually show no detail in them, like these ellipticals, except for a bright bar across the center. This one's a little more edge-on, but the ones that are face-on are basically just a bright glow with a ring in the center. It would look something like this, only without any detail in the arms. And on our diagram, they're right here at the junction of three before you start heading off into the spiral shapes. Another deck shift for no reason at all. All right, so that pretty much gets rid of the ellipticals, excuse me. Like I say, once you've seen a couple, you've seen most of them. Let's go to one of these lenticulars that looks really neat. Find it here in my list. Another one that's fairly close to the rest of these here. And the one next to it is NGC 4754, which is another lenticular. Oh, wait, no. It's not quite as edge on, but this ring in the center is the same sort of structure this is, only we're not seeing it edge on. This is a little bit more face on toward us. Now you can see some of this faint material off the edge of the main disk in the center. The lines behind some of the stars, that was just the deck shifting and the camera shifting slightly. So it's just a streak in the camera feel. This is what they should look like every time, obviously, just round. But I don't know if the wood is just creaking as it cools off or not. I would love to have a better place to set up with a more permanent mount, but to be able to reach the computer, I don't have many options. Anyway, moving on. So that is a lenticular galaxy, or what's classified as a lenticular. I don't think they use that name anymore. I think they have another description of them or a different classification for them. But I'll use it. I've slewed it over to NGC probably take more time and more good frames than we're going to get to really see them in any detail. But on the in the picture of the book I've got here, the Atlas of Galaxies that I was picking and choosing from earlier on, this was quite a nice looking one. Of course, anything is nice when you take it from Hubble. Using the De Vaucouleurs Atlas of Galaxies. It's a nice book published by Wilman Bell a few years back that goes into great detail about all these galaxy types with lots of examples of each. So now you can kind of faintly see the S-shaped arms coming off here. Take a lot longer time than I think we're going to have to see them really well, but they're there faintly. Let's go to a really nice one. Pull the deck again a few times. Black Eye Galaxy is a very nice object with a very distinctive structure. And on the classification diagram, it would fall somewhere around here, very early on in the SA category right here. It's not a barred spiral galaxy, it's just a spiral, and it's one of these early classes, but it's got a very prominent Right, so if that's an SA type, with very little, if any, structure visible, let's go to an SB type, which has more arms visible. It'll get me away from being almost straight south. On our diagram, this guy is right around here on the category. Very tightly packed in. And they call it the sunflower galaxy because when you get the sunflower seeds drying out on the head, you get that kind of mottly, spirally shape. So that's a and SA, SB, right in the transition. Over here to M94, which is a true SB galaxy. I guess they call this one an SAB as well. I beg your pardon. Sort of like the last one. The tightly wound arms again, and this big halo around it this time. Let me see if I can find it. SB real quick. Lots of SCs around. Well, there's plenty of SAs and SCs around, so we're going to go to the closest one I can find here. It's one that everybody's favorite. The good old Whirlpool Galaxy. I don't know if I was pushing the right button last time. There's lots of SAs and SCs around, so we're going to go to the only one I can see really quick that's an SB. And that's the Whirlpool. Here, the central core gets tinier and tinier until all the way out here into the D's, you almost can't tell there even is a central core. The companion is NGC 5195, and they just call it peculiar. We don't want to be insulting, though, but you can see these faint wisps coming off of here are just streams of stars that have been torn away as these two are interacting with each other gravitationally. And the little one is getting torn to pieces and having its stars flung outwards. Be right back. So there you can see a lot more detail in the central core area and see some of the knots where the stars are really firing off and still forming. That's these, this is where the nebulas would be if you were there in that galaxy looking up at their sky, where these bright blue star clouds are. still not too far up. No, this will be just fine. This will be M101, the Big Dipper. Make a mental note of the size of the central core area there and the tightness of the arms on this, on M51 here. Anyway, on our diagram here, M101 falls out here in the SAC category. Maybe tending a little bit toward the barred part of it. There's slight hints of a bar shape across the center here. I was going to look for some barred spirals, and there is a good one in the sky that looks almost just like that, but unfortunately it's not up right now. Give me a minute, I'm going to go see if I can find some that have this kind of nice S shape to them. I think I found one, but it's going to take a while to slew across to it, so it'll be NGC 3953. I'm going to have to go baby this thing and make sure the cords don't get wrapped. I will be right back. And this one is not face on, it's more about 45 degrees tilted toward us. But the bar structure there is pretty clear. Another satellite, wow. The field of view on here is only about half a degree wide, this scale. Our diagram somewhere down in here. It's not as loose as this. It's probably more closer to this. Whoops. And I got to thinking, there is a really nice one right next door to this guy. I didn't even think about when I went on that hunt. M109 of Charles Messier's objects that he discovered. Well, I don't think he discovered M109. I think that got tacked onto his catalog later. I think his stopped at 103 or 104. And a very similar classification as this guy. Now we're getting some good detail in there. while we're in the neighborhood, we need to look at an irregular galaxy, which on the chart here is just all the way over on the side, pretty much categorized. It's the category you dump things you can't otherwise identify. And M82 is a great example of one. Usually called the cigar galaxy. Classified as irregular mainly because they have no idea what, or at least to my knowledge, why it has these sort of perpendicular bands of clouds compared to the orientation of the galaxy lengthwise there. And that's just about all the main galaxy types that you can easily differentiate in a scope this size. You know, with Hubble-sized optics and a lot longer exposure time, you can get all kinds of subtle variations in between these types. Since it's up and since it's right in the way and being a pain in the butt, might as well look at the moon before we go. I unfortunately cannot stay up too extremely late tonight. Yeah, Chris, that's thanks to the jet stream, which is pretty much right over us here today. It's usually a little smoother in the middle of summer when we get big high pressure systems sitting smack on top of us, and there's very little air movement above us. But right now it's down to the south of us, and it's really letting the air swirl around pretty good. It's usually a little better toward dawn as well. I don't really know my lunar geography that well, but really nice detail on the mountains there. Yeah, that's a very distinct possibility too. That right there is a very deep crater. This is just about the best time to be looking at the moon if you're really into the moon. You can spot differences in the amount of light coming into these craters just over 3 or 4 hours as the sun rises in them. You can see right here in the center of this one, just the sun is just barely touching the center of the cone there, or touching the tip of the cone, the impact cone there. In probably 6 hours, if it was still up, it's going to be down in a couple hours, but you'd see that a lot more brightly lit. All right, so looking online, this is Crater Archimedes. And these are the Apennine Mountains. This chart was a little better. Hardly read it. Not on the lunar tracking rate. It keeps creeping out of the view here. There. Stop that. Eratosthenes, yes. Jeez. Or no, that's not Eratosthenes. That's further down. No, that's Eratosthenes, sorry. I'll find one. All right, the Apennine Mountains, the Caucasus Mountains. And we've got Cassini, Archimedes, Aristillus, Autolycus, Eratosthenes, and I'm sure I'm butchering all these Latin names, I apologize. Yeah, you got Plato at the top up here. And Aristoteles. Yes, Greek names. It's getting really late. You're right, Greek. And I really need to do better with you in that regard. one of these nights when we've got steady skies, I'm gonna take a few hundred shots of the moon, zoomed in on the top, the center, and the lower part, and make a really big, hopefully, maybe 8,000 by 8,000 image. Take a whole bunch of them and stack them up and get rid of all the turbulence, and it looks really nice. Anyway, been going about 2 hours here. I hope you all had a good evening. I appreciate it. Appreciate you hanging out. And next good clear dark night, probably in a couple 3 weeks, we'll have the big summertime objects becoming visible over in the western sky, and lots of good stuff in the Milky Way rising over the east. So appreciate you hanging out, and I'm gonna call this one good. Y'all have a good night or day wherever you happen to be.